The World Athletics Council has today taken the decisive action to protect the female category in our sport.
From March 31st, trans athletes who have transitioned after going through male puberty will be banned from top-level female competition.
Many believe there is insufficient evidence that trans women do not retain advantage over biological women.
Of course, the opposite is also true.
They've said there's not enough science. What little science there is has been contested.
Which is why Ko has reserved the right to change his mind.
We're not saying no forever.
Few issues are as divisive as trans participation in sport, but inside athletics, there seems to be a consensus.
The decision was taken in consultation with a number of stakeholders, including 40 member federations, our coaches, our athletes.
Every female elite athlete that I've spoken to would agree. Whether they've got enough courage or opportunity to speak out without feeling they're going to be vilified, I think, is another situation.
But Ko also acknowledges that the ban solves a problem that doesn't currently exist.
There are no transgender athletes competing in international competition in athletics, and no observations therefore exist from the front line, in our case, the field of play.
There is a lot of fear, but where fear exists is where you need to bring in facts. It's where you need to bring in people who do understand what goes on with the body when you make these sorts of changes.
But until we have those facts, the athletics world would rather err on the side of exclusion.
I don't think inclusiveness in this case can override fairness, because fairness is the fundamental philosophy that underpins competitive sport.
We will always do what we think is in the best interest of our sport.
Well, transgender athlete Hannah Mounsey is a former footballer and current handballer and joins us now. Hannah, what do you make of this decision?
Look, it's an interesting one because the IAAF have actually really contradicted themselves. 4 or 5 years ago, they allowed Caster Semenya to compete as an intersex athlete on the basis that testosterone deprivation in their eyes was proven to cause enough of a performance drop that it was fair and equal competition with female athletes. The problem is now they have decided that, no, that's not the case. Testosterone deprivation doesn't affect anyone any differently. You know, so intersex athletes are going to be affected the same way as trans athletes or anyone else. So they can't really pick and choose, which is what they're doing at the moment.
Hannah, you're obviously such a gifted athlete. What does a decision like this, made by a global body, an institution, mean for trans athletes outside of athletics? Will there be a knock-on effect?
I don't think so. Athletics has been pretty out there publicly for a long time as probably being known to not want trans athletes to be included. I think the FINA decision probably helped them come to this decision. But the really interesting thing is the IAAF actually today in making this announcement said it's not based off anything. This is an ideological decision and it's got nothing to do with fairness in competition. They just don't want trans athletes involved at all.
Do you think there is the possibility of having these conversations or reaching decisions, depending on which sport it is, in a way that is sensitive, that does deal with the substance of some of what is being questioned without turning into something that is political or ideological?
No, not at the moment, because that's what is motivating it, and people would need to put those things aside to do that. And part of the problem, and we saw this last year in the federal election, the overwhelming majority of people in these positions that are making these decisions think trans people don't matter. We're not included really at all in any policy decisions or anything past comments in the media like this. So, you know, people are scared of what they don't know, and people aren't wanting to take the time to actually meet trans people and listen to what we have to say and listen to what the experts have to say. If they're able to put, you know, the politics and the money and everything else aside, then, yeah, absolutely, but it's going to take a lot to do that.
Is it scary for you to wade into the discussion publicly? Like, do you consider that before coming on a TV show at night like this to talk about it?
No, not on TV. It's certainly given me pause for concern in terms of my safety in other areas. As recently as yesterday. You know, I live around the corner from Parliament House. I was sort of half tempted to go to that protest yesterday, but there was absolutely no way I was doing that. Like, honestly, I've had, this is going back a few years now, I had a lot of threats against my safety, and that is where it's going. You see, you know, Nazis getting involved on the weekend. You see the hatred towards trans people at the moment, and it's a very slippery slope and it's only going downhill, and people are feeling really emboldened by the fact that there is no pushback. No one's calling it out. We really need people from the Prime Minister down, leaders elected or otherwise, to actually call this out and really apply scrutiny to what is being put in the media. It's not a sporting conversation that we're having anymore. It's around including trans people in society. And at the moment, you know, beating up on trans people gets clicks. It gets views. It's clickbait. And people know that. I've got no problem with people expressing whatever viewpoints they have, but whatever facts they're using to back it up really need to be scrutinised a lot closer, because that's not something that's happened at the moment or in previous years at all.
Hannah, appreciate you coming on tonight. Thanks for talking to us.
No worries. Thank you very much.